Okay. Today we talk about one dimensional motion. I didn't give any homework, so don't worry about the homework. You didn't miss anything. And still, we have some time to start the labs. I upload the presentations to system so you can read them, and recordings are also on the system. You can watch the recordings now. If you don't have any questions about the previous week's topic, we can start today's topic, which is one-dimensional motion. As I told you before, we use university physics of Pearson education, and the presentations comes from that book. Okay, you just missed only one chapter, and it's also in the system. You can watch the recording and you can get the presentation on the system. Okay. Yesterday I checked it. It was available. At the weekend I send an email to the Olearn support, and they say that it is fixed. And yesterday I checked it. Yes, it seems available. Okay. Now, the important definition is the kinematics in that slide. The kinematics is the study of the motion. Okay, when we say that the kinematic of the object, I mean that I talked about the motion of the object. Basically, we have some properties of the motion. The motion is along a straight line. The line may be vertical, horizontal, or slanted, but eventually, at the end of the day, it is just on a line. And the reason of the motion may be forces. And the moving object is either a particle or an object that moves like in a particle. So it means that the size of the moving object is not important for the equations. Okay, a celestial object, the formula for the celestial object is true for the a ball, for example. Okay, now let us look at the some definitions for the one-dimensional case. Then next week we will talk about the general case as more than one-dimensional motion. Okay. Now, the average velocity of the object can be determined as the ratio of the displacement and the time interval that this displacement occurs. Okay. Now, the displacement is just change in the particle's coordinate, and it is shown by delta x, which is x2 minus x1. So delta x equals to x2 minus x1. It is change the position of the object. So how can we express? Let's say these are a starting point, and the object is in position x1 and reaches to position x2. Okay. Sometimes final, we say that this is final position and this one is initial position. So delta x equals to x2 minus x1. It is final minus initial. Since this is subtraction, the result can be positive and negative. So the negative displacement means that the motion is in negative direction, and positive displacement means that the motion is in positive direction. So what are the positive and negative directions? We are in the positive x-axis. So we are in the positive x in the sorry we are in the x-axis. And this is the origin. You know that this is the positive x-axis, positive direction, and this one is the negative direction. Okay. And in the calculation of displacement, before doing that, okay, since it can take positive and negative values, and it gives some direction of the motion, we can say that displacement is a vector quantity. Okay, because if it is positive, the motion is in positive direction. If it is negative, the motion is in negative direction. So it gives us a direction. So remember that if a physical quantity has a direction information, it is a vector quantity. So the displacement is an example of the vector. And in the calculation of the displacement, you should be careful about initial and final positions. Remember, we wrote that delta x equals to x2 minus x1. So the only important thing is initial and final points. The intermediate steps are not important. Okay, what do I mean? Let me clear here. I mean that, for example, mean the origin x1 xc x2. I go xc and I go x1 starting from x, sorry, x2 starting from x1. So in the calculation of displacement that takes, this xc is not important. Okay. The only thing is the final minus initial. Intermediate steps are not important in the calculations of the displacement. Now, let us look at the relation between coordinate and the velocity. If coordinate is in positive direction and it is increasing, so delta x is increasing in positive, so velocity is in positive direction. Okay, and particle is moving in positive direction. Coordinate positive, but it is decreasing. It means that getting less positive. So velocity is negative and particle is moving in negative x direction. Coordinate is negative and the change in the coordinate is getting less negative. So velocity is positive and particle is moving in positive x direction. When everything is negative, the velocity is negative and particle is moving in its negative direction. Okay. Now, the average velocity. Remember the formula that we average equals to delta x over delta t. Okay. And if you have position time graph, you can calculate the average velocity. The slope of the graph will give us the average velocity. And how can we find the slope? It is again the same formula, delta x over delta t. Okay, you just take 2 points. And from these 2 points, you can calculate delta x and delta t from position time graph. Now let us look at an example, but I don't know the reason of this doubling. Okay, first of all, before starting the yes, in the system, it seems fine, but when I try to share with you, it makes this strange page. I don't know. Anyway, Okay, this is the definition of the average speed. In the calculation of the average speed, you just take the total distance covered by the object and you divide the time interval to necessary to cover this total distance. And you should be careful that average distance is a scalar quantity. It is not a vector because the denominator is just a number, the total distance. In the total distance, the intermediate steps are important. You just take average steps. You shouldn't look at the only initial and final positions. You should take the all steps. Now, this is an example. It says that you are on the straight road and you drive the car for 8.4 kilometer at 70. You drive the car for 8.4 kilometer at 70 kilometer per hour. Okay. Yes, I know that. Okay. When you drive 8.4 kilometer, your car stops because of gas. And over the next 30 minutes, you walk 2.0 kilometer farther along the gas station. A, calculate the displacement. B, calculate the time interval. C, calculate the average velocity. Now, let me close the sharing and open a blank page. I think it will be better. Now, we have our starting point. Okay, we start our trip from the origin and we go by car, X car, okay, for 8.4 kilometers. Okay, then it stops because of gas. Then you walk 2 more kilometers. Okay, x walk equals to 2 kilometer to reach gas station. Okay, this is the gas station. First of all, what is the displacement? Remember the formula for the displacement, that x equals to x2 minus x1. What is x1? In the question, it says that from the beginning. So x1 is 0. And what is x2? x2 is this point. So you go with car, then you walk. It means that 8.4 plus 2.0, x2 is 10.4 kilometer. Then delta x will be 10.4 kilometer. So do you have any question? Okay. Now let us look at part B. It says, what is the Everything is erased. Anyway, what is the time interval delta t to reach the gas station from the beginning of the journey? T2 minus T1. T1 is zero because when you start the journey, you just start your stopwatch and obviously it starts from zero. What is T2? Obviously, it contains time spent by car and time by walking. So T car plus T walk. T walk is given in the question as 30 minutes. When you convert to this one as hours, you have 0.5 hours. Okay, this is given in the question. What is T car? You drive 8.5 kilometer with 70 kilometer per hour. So you have 8.4 divided by 70. If I can read my presentation, I would know the results, but now I don't know. 8.4 divided by 70. It is 0.12 hour. So T2 is 0.12 plus 0.5, 0.62 hours. So it means delta T is 0.62 hours. Part C, calculate the average velocity. Remember the definition of average velocity. It is delta x over delta t. Delta x calculated in part A, which is 10.4 kilometer, and delta t is 0.62. It is equal to 10.4 divided by 0.62. Yes, it is 16.8 kilometer per hour. Is it okay? Okay, now let me return the presentation. Where is it? Okay. Suppose you return to the car By walking 45 minutes, what is your average speed for the whole trip? Now you start your journey. You go by car. You go to gas station. This is the gas station. Okay. Then you return to gas station and calculate the average speed as average. In the average speed, remember that numerator is total displacement. Sorry, total distance. Divided by delta t. Now, first let us look at the numerator, total distance, td. What is td? You start the trip from here. You go to gas station. It's 10.4 kilometer, right? Then you return your car. Your car is here. So it is 10.4 plus 2.0. Then total distance is 12.4 kilometer. What is time interval delta t? Again, t2 minus t1. t1 is 0. What is t2? It contains time spent by car, t car, right? T walk. Then t return. T car, we found it in part B, 0.12 hour. T walk is given in the question 0.5 hours, and T return is given in the question as 45 minutes. It is 0.75 hour. So T2 equals to 1.37 hour. So average displacement, average speed is 9.51 kilometer per hour. And part E, what is your average velocity for entire trip? For entire trip, delta x is 8.4 kilometer. You should be careful about that because your x1 is here. This is x car, x gas. You go with car, you go to gas station, and you return the gas station. Okay, so in the calculation of displacement, remember that the initial and final points are important. Here, this is the final point. So it means that you have 8.4 kilometer. So delta x is 8.4 kilometer, but span time does not change. So it is 1.37. So average is 6.13 kilometer per hour. Do you have any question about this example? Okay. Now, let us talk about the instantaneous velocity. It means that the velocity at a specific time. So basically, the velocity that we use in our daily life. Okay. During the course, we skip the word instantaneous. Okay. When we say that velocity, it means that it is instantaneous velocity. As a definition, it is just velocity at a specific time. So when we say that we have a specific time, it means that we don't have any time interval. So the time interval is shrink to zero. When you take the average velocity formula, delta x over delta t, delta t goes to zero. So it is just a definition of the derivative. When you take the limit, delta t goes to zero, you get definition of the derivative. So instantaneous velocity vx or velocity vx is just derivative of the position function with respect to time. Okay. So to define the motion of the object, we must also talk about the acceleration. What is the acceleration? We can talk about the, first of all, average acceleration. If we have some change in the velocity during some time interval, the ratio will give us the average acceleration. Since velocity and average velocity are the vector quantities, the acceleration is also a vector quantity. Okay. So average acceleration is delta v over delta t, this one. And the acceleration at a specific time is just derivative of the velocity vector, velocity function, with respect to time. Now, we have another 3D slide. This one. The position of a particle moving on an x-axis is given by, let me write it, x equals to plus minus at t equals to 3.5 seconds. Calculate its velocity and its acceleration. Now, time is given. there is a specific time, so it means that you should just take the derivative of the derivative of the position function to find the velocity. Okay. When we take the derivative of the position function, the constant term is gone because derivative of a constant is zero. You have 9.2 minus 3 times 2.1 times t square. Okay, and you just put 3.5 instead of t. So Vx, or just V, is 68 meter per second. Okay. Now, the second part is the velocity continuously changing. Look at the velocity formula here. It depends on time. So, yes, the velocity is continuously changing. Okay, since it has time dependence. What is the acceleration? Okay, let me remind you the derivative. Okay. What is its acceleration? So this is the velocity. T square. So when you take the derivative of this velocity, the acceleration will be what? Minus 12.6 t. Then, instead of t, you just write 3.5 seconds, and you will have that a is minus 44.1 meter per second square. Okay. Any question? Now, we learn the idea of displacement, learn how to calculate the velocity, and we learn how to calculate the acceleration of a moving object. So, let us concentrate on the constant acceleration case. So it means that the motion with constant acceleration. In the constant acceleration case, obviously we have a specific acceleration value. And area under a t graph is vx minus v0. It's okay. We already know it. And from here, the area, you can say that a times t, a t equals to vx minus v0. So from here, you can find an expression for the velocity vx is v0 plus 80, right? So what else? Remember, Vx equals to delta x over delta t, right? And in the beginning, let's say delta x is delta t is t, and delta x is x minus x zero. So you already know what is v zero. From there, you can find that this set of equations. Okay. So the derivation is not important for now. You just memorize the equations and you can use the equations depending on the type of the question. What is the famous example for the constant acceleration case? It is just free fall. It is just motion under the gravitational acceleration. In the free fall case, we have an acceleration directed to downward, and we show it as g, gravitational acceleration. And its numerical value is 9.81 meter per second square. And since it is directed to downward, we put minus sign. So let me explain this motion with an example. This is a true story. There is a guy there Monday, and he fall from the top of the Niagara Falls to the water, and he survived. Obviously, he fell with some equipment. But he's still alive. Anyway, he fell 48 meters to the water. When he reached the surface of the water, determine his position at each full second and calculate his velocity when he hit the water. So let me figurize it. He is on the top of the Niagara Falls and he falls down. Anyway, this is the slide for the question. He is on the top of the Niagara Falls and he fell. So his initial position is here, y0 or y1, and your final position, y2. Okay. He goes downward, so y minus y0 equals to minus 48 meters. Okay, do you understand the reason of negative sign? It is above the origin in y-axis. Okay. Okay, let me explain one more time. Let me erase everything. Let us concentrate on the coordinate axis. This is positive y axis, right? And this is origin. So this one is the top of the Niagara Falls. This is your starting point. And when you fall, mount means that you go downward, right? You go downward and reach some point. This is the water. This is why. So when you fall 48 meter in negative y axis, it means that this one is minus 48 meter. So y minus y zero is minus 48 meter. Is it clear now? Okay. Now, what is the position formula? We just take this one. Because from here you can write x minus x zero equals to v zero x t plus 1/2 a x t square. But we are not in the x axis, we are in the y axis. So instead of writing x, we just write y. Okay, we just interchange all x's to y's. Then our expression becomes this one. Since in the question, it says that he fell. He didn't jump. Okay, so it means that the initial velocity v0 is zero. This is the key point. In fact, one of the key points. And A is acceleration. And in free fall, remember that what we said, acceleration is gravitational acceleration with a minus sign. Minus sign refers direction, and g is it is numerical value. Direction. Okay. Yes, it is gravitational acceleration. Then you put everything on the equation. Y minus y zero is minus 48. V zero is zero, so there is no contribution. Then 1/2 at square. This is our acceleration a. So when you calculate t, the result is 3.1 seconds. Okay. In part B, it says that, what is it? Determine his position at each full second. So y minus y zero, yes, v zero t plus 1/2 at square. So determine his position at each full second. Initial velocity is zero, and when t equals to one, y minus y zero equals to minus, or let me write 1/2 minus 9.8 times 1 square. So you have my minus y0 as minus 4.9 meter. Is it understood? Okay, so you can, okay, let me repeat it. Y minus y zero equals to v zero t plus 1/2 at squared. This is our general formula. And the question says that find the position at each full second. So it means that you should take t equals to 1 second, t equals to 2 seconds, and t equals to 3 seconds. So for t equals to 1 second case, this is our question, y minus y zero. We don't know this one. V zero t. This is zero because in the question, okay, I didn't understand why we kept y minus y zero, because when you return the question, it says determine his position at each full second. Okay. So this is our position formula. And he starts his motion from here. Y0. Yes. Here. Yes. You can zero, write zero instead of y zero. So this is zero. And what about a? It is, remember, minus 9.8 meter per second square. Since you are allowed to use calculator, it is better to use the actual of the acceleration. So it's better to use 9.8 instead of 10. So with this example, with this equation, we can calculate the position at each full second. You just change t as 1, 2, and 3. Okay. Then let us look at the third part. Calculate his velocity when he hit the water. Okay, you can calculate his velocity with two different ways. The one way is this one. You just write Vy equals to V0y plus AyT. Okay. V0y is zero and AyT is minus 9.8, and instead of t, we found t. What is it? It is 3.1 seconds. So this is 3.1 seconds. So you just perform this simple multiplication. Or as another way, and in slides I use that way to be more instructive. To show you the another method, we can use the third equation. This one. V0 is zero. This is zero. This is minus 9.8. And x minus x0 is minus 40. 8. So when you perform the multiplication, you have v square equals to let me write to 9.8 and 48. Okay, you will perform the multiplication. But the result is plus or minus 31 meter per second. So which one is the correct result? The negative one is the correct result because our motion is directed downward. And the position is getting bigger and bigger. in a question. Okay. Okay, let us solve a more realistic example. During an auto accident, the vehicle's airbags deploy and slow down the passengers. According to safety standards, airbags produce a maximum acceleration of 60 g that lasts for 36 milliseconds. How far does a person travel in coming to complete stop in 36 meter per second at a constant acceleration of 60 g? Okay. Now, remember the formula x equals to x zero plus v zero t plus 1/2 a t square. Okay. What else? Let's say in the beginning you have x0 equals to 0. Acceleration is given. T is also given. But what about the initial velocity? Since it says how far does a person travel in coming to complete stop, it means that the initial velocity is not zero. It has some value. But what is it? Remember the formula. V equals to V zero plus A T. Okay. Since the person stops, this one is zero. So V zero equals to minus AT. When you write this one to the position formula, x equals to x zero minus 1/2 a t square. We say that in the beginning x zero is zero, so x is just minus 1/2 a t square. Okay. A is 60 g. But it is responsible to stop the person. This acceleration is responsible to stop the person. It means that it is opposite to direction of motion. So we have another minus sign, minus 9.8. Okay. This minus sign comes from direction. Okay. It is opposite to direction of motion. Times t square, which is 36 millisecond. Remember the previous course, we learned that milli is 10 to minus 3. We just take the square. So when you perform the necessary calculation, the result is x 36 times 10 to minus 2 meter. Well, the question says that you can use the 60G here. How far does a person travel in coming to complete stop in 36 meter millisecond at a constant acceleration of 60G? Okay. So the question says that the acceleration is 60G and time is 36 millisecond. And also, let's say this is the car moving with some velocity, okay, and to stop the car, V equals to V0 plus AT, remember that. It is moving with some velocity V0. And at some time later, after some time, it stops, V equals to zero. So how it is possible? It's possible only we have a opposite effect. This is the acceleration, right? If the value of the acceleration is negative, you can stop the car. If acceleration is parallel to the velocity, the velocity of the car will be bigger and bigger. But when the acceleration is opposite to velocity, the velocity is getting smaller and smaller, then it stops. Okay. So, in our final expression, remember that we wrote minus 1/2 AT square. But the acceleration is opposite to the motion. So, we put a minus sign, minus 60G. If the question were, it is not stop, it is accelerating with 60G, and calculate the position, so obviously we have some different formula, we will have different formula, and we will get plus 60G. Anyway. So if it is clear, the slides are finished. So if you don't have any question, we can stop here. Today, we are a little bit quick. Okay. I think everything is clear. So we can stop here. So have a nice day.